Hey, welcome to Trimming the Musical Fat, the podcast where we trim albums that are too damn long. I'm Stephen Nicholson.
And I'm Paul Nicholson.
And in this, our fourth Trimming the Cover Version episode, we're going into full-on Christmas mode with a look at the original 1984 version of Band Aid's Do They Know It's Christmas, Feed the World, and comparing it to the three subsequent versions released in 1989, 2004, and 2014. Please note that we are going to give our opinions on each version of the song, whether it's good or bad. But the one thing we can't criticise is the effort of everyone who took part in creating them to raise millions of pounds for charity. And I think you're in agreement, Paul. We tip our hat to each and every person that was involved in the creation of them, don't we?
Absolutely. Yeah, it was an amazing thing that brought a lot of people together.
Absolutely. And ironic that we do this Christmas episode. We've done a Christmas episode last year, but it's ironic we've had this down to record for a few weeks, and what happened today? It snowed.
All right.
Or is it not snowing in Falkirk?
Not where I am.
Right. Oh, well, it's snowing here in Edinburgh, yeah.
Right.
So, yeah, first snow of the winter, which is rather amusing and very timely. And also why I'm wearing a hat in the attic, because I am absolutely frozen. So that said, let's start with the music. And here's a clip from the original Band Aid version from 1984.
It's Christmas time. There's no need to be afraid. At Christmas time, we let in light and we banish it.
Band Aid were a charity supergroup featuring mainly British and Irish recording artists. It was founded in 1984 by Bob Geldof and Midge Duir to raise money for anti-famine efforts in Ethiopia by releasing the single Do They Know It's Christmas for the Christmas market of that year. On 25th of November 1984, the song was recorded at Sarmes Studios in Notting Hill, London, and was released in the UK on Monday, the 3rd of December. It went straight to number one, outselling all the other records in the chart put together. It stayed at number one for 5 weeks, selling over 3 million copies and becoming easily the biggest selling single of all time in the UK to date. Some of the artists that featured on the track were Phil Collins, Bono, Paul Weller, Sting, Boy George, Paul Young, Simon Le Bon, and George Michael.
So do you remember when you first heard the song?
I think our dad had bought the vinyl. I think everybody's family at that time. That's mm-hmm. what it was quite a, although it was a sad reason why people were, you know, why we were doing it.
Yeah.
In a way, it was a real togetherness, like I said earlier. And everybody's family kind of had that in their record collection that Christmas. So first heard it, probably my dad had it. And then I think we went down to our relatives that played it on his headphones maybe.
Don't remember that. I do remember ex-dad always bought his records at the same place at Lothian Road, so I do remember him stopping outside back when you could park your car outside a shop in the centre of the city and it not cost you anything and it not be double yellow lines. So yeah, I remember him buying that, and I think the first time I maybe heard it's when he played the record at home.
Mm-hmm.
I think
it was on the news and everything, wasn't it?
Oh yeah, you know? It was a major event, wasn't it? What did you think of it then, and what do you think of it now?
I think it's a brilliant song, and they've just got a really. I think when you compare it to the other songs, I think in hindsight, the way they've got the vocals, it all fits just perfectly like one song together, rather than trying to glue them all together. It works really well. It's very cohesive. And I remember when I first said it, it reminded me of Doctor Who, the do 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 do.
Yeah.
So that always reminded me of Doctor Who from that era, the 80s Doctor Who team. And yeah, and Phil Collins' drumming's excellent as well.
And mm-hmm.
His sexy tank top in the video as well.
That's one of the big things for it. That rhythm section in the song still holds up really well. And I think it was maybe the Duran Duran guys that were maybe on the bass and guitar along with Midgeur. And Phil Collins obviously on the drums, but it's got a real drive to it, doesn't it? A real kick to it through the production.
Yeah.
I mean, it's an evergreen Christmas classic, isn't it? And it's a great song. I think the lyrics are obviously very on point. I think it's obviously a very significant song of the 80s. And obviously it raised a hell of a lot of money and raised the profile of famine in Ethiopia. And so it was doing a lot of good as well there. I do like the lyric in it, the greatest gift they'll get this year is life. So there was a couple of lines in the song which did make you think. And you know, the beginning of the song, you know, where it's kind of that slow, mournful kind of chiming bells, which are referenced later in the song. I never knew this until researching it, that is a slowed down sample from a Tears for Fears song. I never knew that. I think it's called The Hurting.
Right, okay.
And another thing which I found out, that is that in the video, and the chorus at the end, the sing-along chorus, you see Status Quo there.
That's right, yeah, and they went involved.
But they don't actually sing. Francis Rossi, the lead singer, doesn't sing any of the verses in the song. So
Panorama as well.
Well, they were meant to. And whatever happened, it was deemed unusable for whatever reason, whether the performance wasn't up to par, or maybe there was a issue with the recording, I don't know. But actually, I've replaced with Paul Weller, Sting, and Glenn Gregory from Heaven 17, got their part instead. And another fact I found out was obviously the you remember who the first singer on the song is? You would have remembered this when you were younger.
Paul Young.
Yeah, Paul Young.
Is it? So, yeah.
Yeah. So Paul Young, do you know who it was originally written for to open the song?
Boy George.
I'll give you a clue. He actually did sing the opening line at Live Aid the following year.
George Michael.
No. David Bowie.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, that was originally written for David Bowie, but he couldn't make the recording, so it was given to Paul Young. But Bowie did sing the.
It sounds like a Bowie line, actually. You know,
it's Christmas time. There's no need to be afraid. Worst David Bowie impersonation ever. Christmas time. It's no time to be afraid. It's Christmas time. Let it lie, vanishing. And, you know, the other thing when you watch, well, you actually have a look down who sings, who performs on it, and you also watch the video, is what is lacking from the lineup?
Female.
Yeah. It's like, in terms, and the more modern, well, workplace, for want of a better expression, there's much more diversity. It's very male and it's very white. Isn't it, when you actually look down at all back then, and then compare it to, say, the 2000 or the 2014 versions, it's very, very different. So that was just one of the things that really stood out to me. So I think we're saying we're both fans of the song. What would you rate this, Paul, out of five? 5 for me as well. Always gets a spin out every Christmas.
Yeah. It's not just that as well. It's the album cover. The single cover was amazing as well. It was just, that was the time of the Christmas songs, really, wasn't it? And yeah, just that in the video and the B-side as well. You had Paul McCartney and David Bowie on the B-side version, who didn't actually sing on the song. So they have a mention on the B-side as well.
Yeah, it's not a great song, and it's not something I would ever really do, which is listen to it loud on headphones, but I did for the purposes of kind of obviously preparing for this, and it was great. Yep, still holds up very well. Okay, that's the original and best, in my opinion.
Unfortunately, it all goes downhill from here.
Well, let's move to 5 years on to 1989. And Band Aid 2. So, Paul, do you want to take us through some facts about the sequel?
Band Aid 2 version was released in 1989, so 5 years on from when the original came out, and produced by British songwriting and production team Stock Aitken and Waterman. It was recorded on the 3rd of December 1989. The song was released the following week on the 11th of December, and it spent 3 weeks at number one, becoming the 9th biggest selling song of that year. Some of the artists that featured on it were Chris Rea, Cliff Richard, Lisa Stansfield, Kylie Minogue and Jason Donovan, and Big Fun. The only artists to feature on this that were part of the original were Sarah and Karen from Bananarama, we talked about earlier.
So, because we have to, let's hear a little bit of the 89 version. So, Paul, Band Aid 2. Well, I think it should have been banned. But what do you think? Before you tell us what you think about this version, when did you first hear it? And did you buy it back in the day?
No. I think I probably heard it on Radio 1 or the chart, or saw it on Top of the Pops or the chart show. It would have been on the news again, because it was almost like the next generation of pop stars doing their Band Aid. So that's probably when I first heard it. Yeah.
I was just saying, for Top of the Pops, maybe something like that. And I certainly did not buy it. And what do you think of it?
Classic. No, for all that the original was good, this was like, you couldn't get any further opposite for this. It was like terrible. Didn't like it at the time, and it sounds even worse now, you know. It sounds so dated. It sounds like, you know, you get those demonstrations on a keyboard or like a karaoke night. It sounds like a karaoke at the pub.
That's what it is. That's it for me. It's the karaoke version, the Sunfly version.
Mm. That's what it is. It's totally undoes all the great work on the original, and just, it's almost like the cheap version, the let's not put any effort in, let's just copy it, but actually not do anything else, just use technology in a way that doesn't take much effort.
Were you surprised that a band containing such musical heavyweights as Big Fun, Bros, Sonia, Jason Donovan and Wet 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 would do an inferior version? Who would have thought?
I know, we compare them with the ones from the 84 version. Yeah, you would have thought they would have been as good, you know, with the great vocal range that Kylie and Jason have, and
I know.
Big Fun and Brother Beyond and all that.
I know, classic acts of the era. It's hard to believe they just couldn't top the 84 original. But yeah, it's obviously, it made sense for them to go to Stock Aitken and Waterman to do it, because you know, whatever you think of them, they were hugely successful.
Yeah.
You know,
No, I was just going to say, I don't really like the sound, but you have to say they were almost like the Phil Spector of the late 80s, you know?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think they held a record or something that they had a top 40 record for, you know, X number of years in the UK charts. So, but yeah, they did have a signature sound, which did ultimately mean that everything started to sound the same. It's like if you put on a song by Sonia or Kylie or Jason, it was all pretty much the same thing. But yeah, it's a product of its time, but the productions, you know, it's timid, light, it's a lightweight pop production. It just sounds, I think the word I would use is vapid. Just doesn't feel like there's any substance to it.
It's like it's watered down,
watered down karaoke version. However, when the video does come on any of the music channels at Christmas time, it's great to watch. Always gives me a chuckle. Some of the people that are on that, on this version. So Paul, what would you give this version out of 5?
-5.
-5. 0.
I think you could do a better version down at a pub on karaoke night than that.
I might actually take you up on that challenge. Mm-hmm. Okay, I would give it, pardon the expression, I would give it 1. So thumbs down for that. Let's move swiftly on to the Band Aid 20 version from 2004, and let's hear a little bit of it. Okay, so that was Band Aid 20. Paul, tell us a bit about it.
Okay, so the song reached number 1 on the 6th of November 2004, which was the 20th anniversary. It spent 4 weeks at the number 1 position and became the biggest selling single of the year for 2004. Some of the artists that featured in it were Bono, Busted, Dido, Paul McCartney, Tom York, Chris Martin, Sugar Babes, Will Young and Miss Dynamite.
Okay, so you remember when you first heard this one?
Probably, it was a big thing on the news again because it was like the 20th anniversary, and plus this was a new version, so it was quite popular at the time. It was just before social media came in, really. Kind of, I think I saw it on the news or Top of the Pops at the time, or heard the song on Radio 1.
Yeah, it was all over the music channels. On TV, but
yeah, that's true. I forgot about
it on Radio 1. Yeah, it was constantly on. Did you buy it? I know I didn't buy it.
No,
I didn't buy it. And well, what did you think of it?
It's far better than the previous one. It's okay. It's pretty average, but it's good that they've maybe tried to add something different to it. I like the sort of tongue-in-cheek. Darkness doing the guitar, that's quite good. I quite like that bit because it's just different.
I mean, just picking up on that, that's one of the things I like about this version, that you do hear some individuality shining through in it, so you can go, oh yeah, that's the guitar of the darkness, or the bit at the end, the instrumental breakdown, that's where it's like Radiohead, right? Obviously Radiohead type things they were playing on it. Whether you like it or not, the Dizzee Rascal rap, which shouldn't have been put anywhere near this song. Here's to you, raise a glass for everyone. Spare a fort this your time for the deprived. If the tables turn, would you survive? Here's to them underneath that burning sun. You ain't gotta feel guilt, just selfless. Give a little help to the helpless. Do they know it's Christmas time? But yes, it's individual. Although I don't think it should have been put on there. What else? And what's in the negatives for you?
how can you top a classic? I suppose it's kind of like, at least it's not, there is effort went into it and they've added, tried to add bits into it of the time, whereas previous one was just like, yeah, like a watered down one like we talked about. But it's just, yeah, just pretty average, really.
Okay. I'm not going to disagree with you, actually, on this. I never owned it, and I listened to this at the weekend for the first time, again, loud on headphones, and I think it's a really good version. I think this has the same spirit as the 84 original, something that was lacking from Band Aid 2, and I think it's like the garage band version of it. It is quite rough and ready, the way it's been done and produced. I like that. It's very stripped back, but there's a good mix of talent on it. As I mentioned before, I think the individuality of some artists comes through, whether it's Radiohead, Darkness, Coldplay. It's very diverse. You know, I mentioned 84 being very white and very male. This has got, a huge number of women on it. I've mentioned already about the rap there, and I like the bit about the 2 minute 20 mark where it goes into that quiet feed the world, you know, before kicking back in. To the chorus, which is really quite nice. So I actually really quite like this version a lot. Not as good as the original, but yeah, it's good. Stands on its own right for me. So what would you give this out of 5?
2.
2? Well, I would give it, I'd be a bit more forgiving and give it 4. And I say to you, bah humbug. Okay, let's go to Band-Aid 30.
Forward 10 years.
Yes, we jump forward 10 years to Band-Aid 30, which was 2014. And let's play a little bit of it. All right, so that was Band-Aid 30. Paul, tell us a bit about it.
So this version of the song debuted at the chart summit during the week of its release. Then it dropped down a place in each of the following 2 weeks before dropping out of the top 10 in its fourth week. It also received a polarised reception from many critics due to its new lyric directed towards Africa. Artists that featured in it were Bono for the third time, Roger Taylor, Queen, did drums in it, Ed Sheeran, Ellie Goulding, One Direction, Sam Smith, Glenn Bandit, Paloma Faith, Rita Ora, and Ollie Mars.
Yeah, so Paul, did you buy this when it came out? Why not, Paul?
Just because it's not very good.
It's not, is it? It's, I've kind of went through these, and it's like the original is the classic. The second one is the karaoke version. The third one's the garage band version. And this one is the vanilla version. Mm-hmm. It's like a really tasteless meal. The ingredients are there, you know, to make it, but it's just bland. It's inoffensive. It's pointless. This feels like a cover version. And I know they decided to change the lyrics which again, why?
Lyrics,
it just yeah. I know it just doesn't seem right, and yeah, it's just it's bland. It's just mm-hmm. there's we talked about maybe the individuality shining through on Band Aid 20. On this, where is that? It's just this pleasant, boring run through the song,
mm-hmm.
changing some of the lyrics.
Yeah, it's just cringy.
Are we being harsh? Oh, no, maybe we're not. I mean, I think the performance of it maybe says it all.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't do all that well compared to the other versions.
And also, very rarely do you get anybody talking about it as a good experience. You know, or it was very much at the time it was seen as, oh yeah, it's great. And obviously for us big Queen fans seeing Roger Taylor doing the drums, I would imagine if he looked on that now, he'd probably not be too happy with the memory of doing that.
To be fair, Roger Taylor pretty much moans about everything. So.
Yeah.
So I'm sure he would find fault with something. Alrighty, so I think we're giving this one a thumb. Both of us are giving it a thumbs down. What would you give this out of five?
One.
I'm going to go two. I would give this one two. I think it's, yes, it's bland, but I think it's still a little bit better than Band Aid 2. So this is probably going to be no surprise then. If we were to be thrown onto a desert island and we're only allowed to take one of the four versions, which would we take? So, well, I think it's very obvious I'm taking the original. What about you? Yep, so we're taking Band-Aid, the original, to the desert island. And we thought, while we're here, obviously we're looking at Band-Aid, we thought we might take a look at the USA for Africa effort from 1985, We Are the World, written by Michael Jackson and Lionel Richie, if memory serves, which was a number one hit, I think, on both sides of the Atlantic back in 85. Let's hear a little bit of it.
Change. We all a part of God's great big family. And the truth, you know, love is all we need. We are the world. We are the children. We are the ones who make a brighter the day. So let's start giving.
So,
there comes a time.
We are the world.
We are the children.
You remember hearing this back in the day, Paul?
Unfortunately, yes. Top of the Pops. At the time, obviously, we didn't have MTV and VH1 in our house at that time.
Well, they had four channels.
What's that?
Well, they had four channels in the UK at the time.
So, probably. So on Top of the Pops, it would have been on the news as well because obviously it was the US's version of Band-Aid, so it would have been on the news and a lot of hype. Obviously, a lot of massive stars were in it at the time. So.
Mm-hmm. What do you think of it as a song?
Absolutely shocking. It's terrible. even today, I listened to it a couple of times just to remind myself, and it just confirmed how bad it is. It's so sickly sweet and it just doesn't feel authentic, doesn't feel genuine. I don't know. I know
what you should be. Paul, there are people dying.
But I just think the big problem with it, we've talked about before, is that it feels like different singers all competing. who can do the highest note. It just doesn't like merge as one song. It just sounds like bits of songs put together. Whereas the original UK one was a really good song. It just flowed really well. There's good balance to it. And people sung the bits appropriate to that song, almost like the tone and everything. Whereas this one, it feels like it's going, they're all trying to outdo each other, but it makes it sound messy. And a lot of brilliant artists on it as well.
I've not listened to this song in years. I never bought it at the time, but I've not listened to this song in years. And
good video.
Yeah, and I just thought, right, let's put it on, give it a listen. And after something back in the day, I quite liked the song. And now, no, it's, as you say, it's schmaltzy, it's sickly sweet, it's got a very dated production. You're reminded though how many legends are actually on it, and you're like, oh, Bob Dylan was on this, or oh, Dionne Warwick was on this. It's, yeah, unbelievable the amount of, I think this was recorded after the Grammys that year. I'm sure it was after the Grammys, and they were then went to the recording studio, which is why they could get everybody together. And I'm pretty sure this story is true. They were obviously, while they were there, having, you know, the fanciest food and everything while they were recording
Bob Geldof story, yeah.
That's right, and Bob Geldof turned up and gave them a ticking off.
You know? Yeah, because I think he turned up, and obviously there's all these egos and stuff, as there would be anyway, but he went in, kind of, the recording studio, I don't know if they knew that he was coming, but he went in, and he saw all this really expensive food that was just lying there that nobody had touched. It was like totally contradicting what the message was. It was about feed the world, and then they're wasting all this expensive food.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was quite annoyed with them for. But do you know, if it raised awareness and made money, that's good. But just like you, I think I liked it at the time, but it's just so cringeworthy, the lyrics, and it's almost like a spoof. That's what it's like. It's like, how can you, it's like, you know, like, yeah.
Do you know, when I was saying there are people dying, that's not even the song. That's Heal the World.
That's Michael Jackson.
Yeah. By Michael Jackson, which is pretty much the exact same song as We Are the World.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, just thinking that there, it's not even that song. The other thing is, this goes on for 7 minutes.
I
didn't remember it being that long, and
it does feel
like 7 minutes, doesn't it?
It's almost like the one that the UK Band-Aid one, but it was good about it. It was quite short and sharp, got to the point. Whereas this one, it's like, we've got all these stars, how can we try and fit them all in, rather than just saying, look, we've only got this time, we can only put so many in. But it's almost like they want to accommodate everybody to get a bit. It just didn't work.
I'll tell you, Prince dodged a bullet. He decided to go partying instead of going to this. But yeah, I mean, what's the best bit of this version? Because I know what my favourite bit is.
I know the bit you mean.
I don't even know what you're doing right now.
Is it the bit when Huey Lewis starts singing that bit? No.
Oh, no. It's got to be the Bruce Springsteen bit.
Oh, yeah. Bruce Springsteen constipated face, yeah.
It's like, right, I'm the person to bring gravitas to this song.
Another one who I think, and they're brilliant singers as well, but like, another one who ruins it is Cyndi Lauper. She just goes too far over the top.
yeah.
It's like it comes out of nowhere, and it's just like...
That stood out to me as well, yeah, listening back.
I'd love to have heard, because you can get the live version, the UK one, and I would love, because obviously Freddie Queen would love to have been on it, but at the time they couldn't. I don't know if they were going to be blacklisted as well because of the South Africa thing that year, but it would have been good to hear, because in Live Aid, they do the song at the end, and Freddie comes on, a lot of people who'd been on come back on for the finale, and Freddie's got his red vest on. It would have been good to have heard the vocals if somebody had the vocals for Freddie singing it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And Paul McCartney and George Michael, I think it was.
Yeah. So I think in this contest, we're saying the UK beats the US when we're comparing the originals here. But do you know who the true winner is, Paul? Charity.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And as we said at the beginning, we're just giving our opinion on each version of the song. One of the things that we're certainly not criticizing is all the people involved and making each of these records happen and raising awareness and making money for charity. So fair play to everyone involved. So time to go feed ourselves, Paul. So Christmas is coming up. What are you going to be doing Christmas Day?
Not too sure, actually. Probably see family, watch TV, maybe watch a Christmas film, and yeah. What about you?
I think my main objective that day is to go up to Mum and Dad's to try and eat as many turkey sandwiches and bits of Christmas cake as possible. I think that's my main motivation. Yeah, I don't know, no real firm plans, just see what happens, which is quite nice. It's actually first Christmas in ages where we don't need to go off anywhere, nobody has to fly anywhere or visit somebody or anything, so that's quite nice.
I suppose as well, it's our first Christmas in about 3 years, really, that it'll feel like
normal.
Christmas.
You know, that's right, yeah, no, for the COVID, yeah, no restrictions or anything, so
yeah,
yeah, looking forward to it. But yeah, before we go, Paul and I just wanted to say a big thank you to you all for supporting us and listening to us over the course of this year. We really, really appreciate it, and we hope you have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. So let's keep trimming in 2023. So Merry Christmas, and we'll see you next year.
Trimming the Musical Fat Podcast is a Stephen and Paul Nicholson production. Contact us via voicemail by going to anchor.fm/TTMF/message, or tweet us at Musical Trimming, or email us at trimmingthemusicfat@gmail.com by joining our Facebook group or visiting our website www.trimmingthemusicalfat.com. Or support us financially by going to Patreon and getting some great podcast exclusives.